It's a joy to welcome you to our Wednesday night rabbit chasing time. I've been doing a book of questions by a British pastor named Richard Buse called Top 100 Questions. Sometimes I've thrown in my own question, but tonight it's one of those. And here's the title that was on the chapter and the question that was sent in. Having begun as a Christian, I get so dispirited at my same old sins, I keep thinking that I'll have to go back to the beginning again. Boy, my heart goes out to the person that wrote that because I understand that feeling. I can remember not many weeks ago, I was sitting in my quiet time and looking at my life thinking, man, I've been at this so long. Why am I not further along than what I am? I think all of us who are honest would give that evaluation of our life. And can I tell you one of the reasons why a person like that gets so discouraged? And this is one of my pet peeves. I believe we need far more transparency among us Christians. We put on our church smiles and we talk about our victories and we give people the impression that there's some people out there that got it all together. No, they don't. I watch some of these TV preachers, they give me the impression that they're going from a string of one victory to another and you can have the same victory as them if you'll just send them your money and buy their book. Ron Dunn was a part of a refreshing group of Baptists that God raised up in the 1970s who began to teach Baptists about things like how to be filled with the Holy Spirit. That had been completely not even a part of our Baptist life until Ron Dunn, Jack Taylor, that group. We nicknamed them the Deeper Life Teachers. I had Ron Dunn for the first time in 1987. We went out for a meal. And I'll never forget something he said to me because those were my heroes. I'd traveled to go hear these folk. And he said this, all of those are my close friends. I know all of the ones that are going around talking about the deeper Christian life. And I'll be honest with you. I know their lives. And they're not living substantially better lives than the people they're preaching to. And the longer I live, the more I understand that. I think, folks, we've got to be open and honest about the fact that we still struggle. When I left one particular church, that's awkward because people want to say something to you. And sometimes it's a backhanded compliment. And I had one little lady came and says, Pastor Steve, you're the third pastor we've had at this church. And I put all the pastors up on a pedestal, but I felt like you were right down here on my level. All the other pastors said they were sinners, but I believe you. And I thought, thank God. Thank God I had not come across as somebody made of different stuff. That I had a person come to me one time and say, Pastor Steve, I just don't have what you have. I looked at her and I said, please, would you forgive me? Because I've given you the impression that's not true. I don't have it either. I love Paul's transparency. Paul talked about in a verse that I used in a talk just the other day about the fact that when he was in Asia in 2 Corinthians 1, that he got in such a trial that he despaired of life. It was more than he could bear. I thank God that a man like Paul would share that he has struggles. But as to this point, I get dispirited at my same old sins. Let me read you some words that show the transparency of Paul. I'll be using the New Living Translation. These words were written in AD 58 after his third missionary journey was over. He's a veteran missionary. Within a few months, he will be arrested and spend the next 5 years in prison. Toward the end of his life now when he writes this. Romans 7, 18 through 24. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is in my sinful nature. I want to do what's right, but I can't. I want to do what's good, but I don't. I don't want to do what's wrong, but I do it anyway. If I do what I don't want to do, I'm not really the one doing it. It's sin living in me that does it. I've discovered this principle of life, that when I want to do what is right, I inevitably do what is wrong. I love God's law with all my heart, but there's another power within me that is at war with my mind. This power makes me a slave to the sin that's still in me. What a miserable person I am. Who will free me from this life that is dominated by sin and death? If Paul, at the end of his ministry, said that, then why should we expect a different type of experience? Well, Richard Buse, when he's dealing with this subject about why so many times we feel discouraged because we face these temptations and we still fall, he gives encouragement and he says this, that ought to encourage you because strong temptations are the sign the devil's after you. I heard somebody say, you're either butting heads with the devil or you're going along with him. So the very fact that you have been receiving those temptations and the very fact that you're aware of your failures is something that says Satan has considered you to be somebody who is a worthy target. Now, what Satan does in those temptations, he basically does two things. He does something before and something afterwards. Before you fall, when he tempts you, he basically whispers and says, you do this, you'll enjoy it. It won't hurt you. You'll be an exception. You'll get away with it. And then you sin, and of course you don't get away with it. Then Satan is right there afterwards, and he says this, now you've blown it. God doesn't want any more to do with you. The Christians, you shouldn't even hold your head up and say you're a Christian. Do you see how Satan works? But that's what he does. He attacks those who are true Christians, and it's actually a badge that he's attacking you. A second truth you need to know when you look at the fact that we have this tug of war inside, you need to know this from God's word. Please listen to me. This will be a lifelong battle. Galatians 5, verse 16 and 17 says this, I say then, walk in the Spirit, and you shall not fulfill the lust or desire of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary to one another, so that you cannot do the things you wish. Now notice that that part of me that pulls me towards sin is called the flesh. That indicates to me, as long as I got this body, something in me is going to be pulling me away from God and into sin. It's a lifelong thing. And I want you to know this. This is a sobering thought. No matter how long you've been a Christian, you're still capable of any sin 1 second after you stop consciously drawing upon the power of the Holy Spirit. You're going to have to know that, because this is a battle that will never end. And he says that what you find, the flesh lusts against the Spirit, has its desire set against the Spirit lusts against the flesh. You cannot do the things you wish. Can I just tell you what's going to be the reality? Because in America, we like to think that, do you remember those commercials, how to lose weight without diet or exercise? We like to tell people that you can have it all with no problem. Can I just tell you, I'm living proof that you can't lose weight without diet or exercise. I've been trying that for years, and it's not worked. How to become a millionaire by the time you're 30 with 3 easy steps ain't going to happen. So what it says here is, I choose to walk in the Spirit. By choosing to walk in the Spirit, I say no to the flesh. Either the Spirit or the flesh will be grieved. I'll give you something that's practical in this day and time, because there's so much available on streaming and such now that a Christian shouldn't watch, and somebody will be talking, have you seen this new series? And it's full of scenes that a Christian shouldn't see. So your flesh says, just watch it. It won't bother you. And the Holy Spirit says, don't bring me into that. I live inside of you. And so if you choose not to watch it, your flesh is going to be pouting. If you choose to watch it, the Holy Spirit will be there and he'll be grieved. That's going to be the battle. Number 3, and I got 2 real quick ones. All right, it's a lifelong battle, but we can and will get better. Philippians chapter 3, not that I've already attained or am already perfected, but I press on that I may lay hold of that for which Christ Jesus has laid hold of me. Brethren, I do not count myself to have apprehended, but one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forward to those things which are ahead, I press toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul says, I want to tell you something, I'm not there yet, but I'm straining toward that. See, we have the Holy Spirit living in us. Did you hear what his first name is? Holy. And he lives inside of me. So he's empowering me and he's pulling me toward holiness. And I want to get there because he saved me and changed me. Philippians 1:6 in the same book of Philippians. He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion by the day of Christ Jesus. He's not going to stop working on us. So let me just say what most Christians could say right now. I'm not what I should be, but I'm not what I was. And that's where we are. But one more thought. I believe the discouraged Christian needs to also cherish the doctrine of eternal security. The fact that I can't lose my salvation. Can I remind you the verses I read in Romans 7 where Paul says, who's going to deliver me from this bondage of death? What wretched man that I am. That's how Romans 7 ends. Romans 8 begins this way. There's therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. Boy, when we've been through a Romans 7 moment, don't we need to hear Romans 8:1? He's already forgiven you. There's no condemnation. Romans 8, 38 and 39, nothing will separate me from his love. Nothing now, nothing in the future. So let me read you some words from Views as I get ready to close. Learn the unique truth of justification. Once we accept Christ's saving death for us, we're said to already, from then on, be justified in God's sight. Justification then is more than forgiveness, acquittal or pardon. If we're simply forgiven, there would always be still the uncertainty of what happens when we sin again. But folks, what's happened is we've been more than had declared innocent. We've been given the righteousness of Christ. That's already put on your account. Steve Brown, his daughter one time was signed up for AP English, the advanced English. She went to the first class. She was somebody who could not make a B. Emotionally, she couldn't handle making a B. She went to the first class. The teacher said everything that they'd have to do. She went home, began to cry, and says, "Daddy, you got to go to class with me. I'm not going to be able to do this. And would you come? I can't tell the teacher about it. Will you go with me and tell her that she needs to transfer me to regular English because I'll not be able to do this?" And so the next day he wanted to be his daughter's hero. He walked in and said, "Ma'am, I know you're a good teacher, but my daughter and I have talked, and she feels like she needs to be in regular English and not AP English." And the teacher says, "You know, I've looked over your daughter's record. I believe she'll be able to do it and will do a good job. But I sense that what she's worried about is the grade. So, Miss Brown, if I go ahead and give you an A right now, do you think you'll stay in the class and do your best?" And so she'd been over there crying, and she went, "I think I can." So the teacher reached in and put an A in the book. "You've already got your A. I just want you to come and do your best." And at the end of the semester, she'd earned the A. Folks, got good news. You've been given the righteousness of Christ. You already have an A. You may be struggling right now, but you already have an A. Let that bless your heart. Oh, God, discouraged Christians are here listening to this now, but you've never given up on them. You love them. You have secured them so that heaven will be theirs. Your Holy Spirit lives in them. I pray in the name of Jesus that you'll just lift up hearts tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.